हेलो स्टूडेंट, टुडे आई एम टेकिंग द क्लास 8 सोशल साइंस हिस्ट्री चैप्टर 8 सिविलाइजिंग द नेटिव एजुकेटिंग द नेशंस। माय डियर स्टूडेंट्स, हियर वी आर गोइंग टू स्टडी दैट हाउ द ब्रिटिश सॉ एजुकेशन इन इंडिया, व्हाट आर द ट्रेडिशंस ऑफ ओरिएंटलिज्म्स, व्हाट आर द ऑफिशियल ऑफ ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी डन, व्हाट आर द एरर्स दे फाइंड, and how the English Education Act started off from 1835, how the education for commerce. So we will study details how the new concept of education entered in our country, how they started and earlier which type of education we are taking. So see, the East India Company, when they established control over whole country of India, British in India, early they control not only the territorial, they conquest, they control revenues. Now they had a cultural mission also, they want to change this. They thought that they had to be cultivate the natives and change their customs and values of India. So what they done, how the British saw education. So see the answer, the Britishers had their own views about how Indians were to be educated, but some Indian leaders had their own ideas that how to improve educations among the Indians. What are the tradition of Orientalism? You see, in 1783, William Jones, a linguistics, he arrived in Calcutta as a junior at the Supreme Court. Jones began to study. He started studying the ancient Indian texts related on law, philosophy, religion, politics, moralities, arithmetic, medicines and other science. All he studied. Henry Thomas, Colebrook and the Nathaniel Hallett were also busy. They were also busy in discovering the Indian ancient heritage, mastering Indian languages, and they translating the Sanskrit and Persian works into English. These type of work they done together with. Now, William Jones set up the Asiatic Society of Bengal and started a journal. That journal is called Asiatic Researches. Now, Jones and Colebrook realized that in order to understand India, they want to understand India, it was necessary to discover the sacred and legal text of ancient period. Then they know about in detail. They both shared a deep respect for ancient cultures of India, both of India and West. Jones and Colebrook went about discovering the ancient texts and they interpret their meaning to others. What are the officials of East India Company done? Do you know many company officials got influenced by the findings of Jones and Colebrooks? They felt that the institution should be set up. Why? Because it encouraged the study of ancient Indian text and they teach Sanskrit and Persian literature and poetry. So the British hoped to win place in the heart of the native Indians. How? By teaching them the language they were familiar with. So they decided. For this, what the British has done? So Britishers set up Calcutta in 1781 to promote the study of Indian texts, and they started teaching Sanskrit and Indian by teaching them the language they were familiar with. For this, the British set up an Oriental Institute. Which type of institutions? Like a madrasa. It was set up in Calcutta in 1781 to promote the study of Arabic, Persian and Islamic law. Next one, the Hindu College was established in Banaras in 1791 to encourage the study of ancient Sanskrit texts, so it would be useful for the administration of the country. So you have seen how they established these two institutions. But some error that give error of the is maybe some errors. How? See, by the 1830s, the attacks of the Orientalist vision of the learning become stronger. How? Critics like, some of the critics like James Mill and the Thomas Macaulay, they saw India as an uncivilized country, and what they think that needed to be civilized, means they are thinking they are uncivilized and they have to be civilized. So what they done, he emphasized the need to teach English language and urged the British government to stop wasting public money in promoting Oriental learning. So these are the errors came from the East. Now you see how the English Education Act. So English Education Act started of 1835. What is written on it? See, the main features of this English Education Act of 1835 was, first one, English became the medium of higher education. First, second one, the decision was medium of higher education. And English textbooks were produced for schools. So these are in the act. Education for commerce, what they done? Now in 1854, an educational dispatch, means sending away in great speed, it was introduced in India, which emphasized the practical benefits of a system of this European learning as opposed to Oriental knowledge. Now, what are the advantage of this Woods dispatch for the British in India? See here, one of the important point that Woods dispatch pointed out was economy. Main aim, European learning would enable India to recognize the advantage of what expansion of trade and commerce, that is the main aim. Now, you see the European way of life would change. It changed the tastes and desires of these Indians, and the Indians would begin to appreciate and what they buy European products. That is the main aim. So do you know European learning would also improve the moral characters of Indians. It would make them truthful and honest, and thus supply the company with trusted civil servants. That is the main target. Now, following this, the 1854 dispatch, some measures were taken, some measures they had, which are taken by the British, that education department of the government were set up. First, second, universities were established in Calcutta, Madras and Bombay, and attempts were made to change the existing school system. The school system which was earlier, they want to change it. Now, what about the local school? How it was early in India? Do you know? In the 1830, a Scottish missionary, William Adam, toured the districts of Bengal and Bihar to make report on the progress of education in vernacular schools. Vernacular means local school, the village. So the reporter, what is the report written by the William Adams? See, over the 1 lakh pathshala existed in Bengal and Bihar, and these pathshala were small institution with no more than 20 students each. Do you know the total number of children began taught in these pathshalas were near about 20 lakhs. Now, the system of education in the local school, that is known as pathshala, was flexible. There were no fixed fee, no printed books, no separate school buildings, no benches or chairs, no blackboards, no system of separate classes, no annual examination and no regular timetable, etc. See, in some places, do you know, the classes were held in open space. In corner of the village, shop or a temple or at the guru's home. In this way they are teaching. Teaching in these schools was mostly oral, and the guru, the teacher, decided what to teach. So Adam found that this flexible system was suited for the local poor children. So they will come to the school, at least they will learn something. New routines, new rules. After that, what type of the new rules started? After 1854, the company decided, they decide to improve the system of vernacular education. What they done? See, it appointed a number of pandits, each in charge. They are in charge of looking after 4 to 5 school. This is their duty. The task of pandit, what is the task? Pandit was to visit the Pathshala and try to improve the standard of teaching. These are the main tasks. Do you know, new rules and routines were introduced. Now the students were asked to pay regular fee, attend regular classes and appear in annual examination. These are the new setups. Now Pathshala, which appeared, the new rules were supported through government grants. Now what are the, after establish this, what type of new agenda for a national education? Do you know, not only British officials but some of the Indians, they also feels that Western education would help modernize India. So they asked the British to open some more schools, some colleges and universities. And there were other Indians like Mahatma Gandhi and Rabindranath Tagore who reacted strongly against this Western education. What did I see? English education has enslaved us. Mahatma Gandhi argued that the colonial education created a sense of inferiority in the middle of Indians. Those who educated in this institution began admiring British rules, and Gandhiji wanted such an education system that would help Indian to regain their sense of dignity and self-respect. And he felt that the Indian languages ought to be the medium of teaching, so we will feel that we are Indians. Now, education in English, what he thinking that education in English crippled Indians, distant them from own social surroundings, made them strangers in their own land. That is why he opposed this system. Gandhiji argued that the education ought to develop a person's mind and soul. People must learn at craft and they had to work with their hands, and they know how different things will be operated. This would develop their, if they follow this, so it will develop their minds and their capacity to understand. As nationalist sentiment spread, people began thinking of system of national education. Tagore's abode of peace. What is the thinking of Tagore about this education? You see, Rabindranath Tagore started an institution, Shanti Niketan, in 1901. As a child, he hated going to school and found the system of education, what the he is thinking during that time, as suffocating and it is oppressive. Later he wanted to set up a school which the child was feeling happy and could be able to explore her own thoughts, their own thoughts and desires. So according to Tagore, the existing school systems, what it killed the natural desire of the child and to be creative and the sense of wonder. So what the Tagore thought that the creative learning could be encouraged only with what? A natural environment. Thus he set up a school where the child was happy and could be able to explore his own thoughts and desire. So according to Tagore, the existing school systems, it killed the natural desire of the child to be creative and the sense of wonder. Do you know? Tagore thought that creative learning could be encouraged only with the natural environment. Thus, he set up a school 100 km away from Calcutta in a rural setting. Tagore saw the area of his institution was an abode of peace. He had given Shanti Niketan, where living in harmony, the children lived with harmony with nature, children could be able to be creative and a sense of wonder. Tagore thought creative learning could be encouraged only with the natural environment, not in a room. Thus, he set up school now in ruling the area of institution and were living in harmony with nature. Now, children could be able to enhance their natural creativity. Now, Tagore wanted to combine elements of modern Western civilization with best Indian traditional. Thus, he emphasized the need to teach science and technology at Shantiniketan along with art, music and dance. Now, so we had finished this topic, how the education in Indian forms and British. Now, what are the question answers? See first one. Why did your William Jones feels that the need to study Indian history, philosophy and law? Now, William Jones felt that the study Indian history, philosophy and law due to following reason. What is the first reason? William Jones had a deep respect for ancient cultures, both for India and the West. Second one, he thought that the Indian civilization had attained its glory in the ancient past, but you know, subsequently declined. Third point, he believed that in order to understand, it was necessary to discover the scat and legal text of ancient period, that is also. See the next question. Why did the James Mill and Thomas Macaulay think that European education was essential in India? What are the reasons? See, what then? James Mill was a severe critic of Orientalism. He thought that the European education was essential in India. Why? Because he had seen some reasons. It is written, the knowledge of East was full of errors and unscientific thought. The aim of education ought to be teach what was useful and practical. Thomas Macaulay, what he suggested that first, India was uncivilized country that needed to be civilized. Second, no branch of Eastern knowledge could be compared to the Western knowledge. Oriental learning was no practical use. Now, next question, why did the Mahatma Gandhi want to teach children handicraft? Mahatma Gandhi wanted to teach children the handicraft for the following reason. See, what are the first reason? Education ought to develop person's mind and soul. So, simple learning to read and write by itself did not count as education. If children are allowed, what he said, to work with hands, learn a craft and know how the different things are operated, so it could be help their mind and their capacity to understand. Next question, why did the Mahatma Gandhi think that English education had enslaved Indians? Reason, Mahatma Gandhi thought that the Western education was sinful. There was a poison in this education. How? Because he thinking the colonial education, it created a sense of inferiority in the minds of the Indians. Indian educated in these institutions, they started appreciating everything that came from the West and began admiring British rule. That is why the reason. It made them Western civilization as superior. And this education, it destroyed the pride and they had their old culture and the country. See the next question. See. Now it is finished. Now I am taking the history chapter 9, Women, Caste and Reforms. My dear students, when we see in the detail, now the conditions of women, either they are belonging to the rich family or poor family, it was not good in early time. How? See, women 200 years ago. What are the conditions of women 200 years ago? Do you know? 200 years ago, our society was very different. How? Most of the children were married off at an early age. And both Hindu and Muslim men could marry more than one wife. And there were many restrictions on women during that time. Do you know? In some parts of the country, the widows were praised if they choose to be sati by burning themselves on the funeral pyre of their husbands. Women's rights to property were restricted. They will not get the rights, these property. Most of the women had to no access to education. These are the conditions in earlier. Do you know? In most regions, people were divided along lines of caste, Brahmins, Kshatriyas, Vaishyas and Shudras. So over the 19th and 20th century, these norms and perceptions slowly change. Working toward change. What type of work done to change these things? See, from the early 19th century, there were development in new forms of communication. How? Some books, newspaper, magazines, leaflets, pamphlets, it was printed. People read this and took part in the debates and discussions in social affairs, political, economics and religious issues. So in this way, the thinkings were changed. Do you know some of the, who had changed this? Some peoples. So first one is Raja Ram Mohan Roy, 1772 to 1826. Do you know? He founded a reform association. Reforms he want to change the society. So he founded a reform association that is known as Brahmo Sabha. And later it was known as Brahmo Samaj in Calcutta. What he done? He wanted to spread the knowledge of Western education and India and being about greater freedom and equality of women. He support this. He had changed the lives of the widow. Ram Mohan Roy strongly disapproved the miserable conditions of widows in our society. He said that the practice of widow burning had no sanction of any ancient text. And he started campaign against these sati systems. Do you know during that time, even the British official also supported the Ram Mohan Roy and stand in 1822 sati system was banned. Next is the reformer Ishwar Chandra Vidya Sagar. Do you know? He was one of the most famous reformer of the 19th century. He used the ancient text to suggest that widow could remarry. His suggestions were adopted by British officials and law was passed permitting widow remarriage in 1856. The movement in favor of widow remarriage spread to other parts of the country also. Do you know in the Madras presidency, Veera Salingam Pantulu, in Bombay, young intellectual and reformers, and in North India, Swami Devanand Saraswati supported these movements, and the conservative groups continue. Some of the conservative groups, they continue oppose this new law. The widows who remarried were not, but in our society it will be accepted? No, in our society the widow who remarried were not easily accepted in the society. Next, can girls begin going to school? See, social reformers felt that the education for girls was necessary in order to improve the overall conditions of women. Vidya Sagar in Calcutta, Arya Samaj in Punjab and Jyoti Rao Phule in Maharashtra, they set up the schools for the girls. Do you know, those who oppose women education, why they oppose? Because they thought that the education prevented women from doing their domestic duties and it would be have a corrupting influence on them. That is the main reason. Throughout the 19th century, most of the educated women were taught at home by liberal fathers and husbands. Dude, one of the famous Rashundra Devi, do you know she secretly learned how to read and write in the flickering lights of candles at night. Now, in aristocratic Muslims households in North India, we can see women learn to read the Quran in Arabic. Reformers like Mumtaz Ali reinterpret to support the women's education. Now, we will see women write about women. Now, in modern history, there were two prominent women who worked for the women education. They were first Begum Rukaiya Shakhawat. See, Muslim women like Begum of Bhopal played a significant role in promoting education among women. Do you know? बेगम रुकैया शेखावत हुसैन स्टार्टेड स्कूल फॉर द मुस्लिम गर्ल्स इन पटना एंड कैलकटा. नेक्स्ट, ताराबाई शिंदे एंड पंडिता रमाबाई. बाय द 1880s, इंडियन वीमेन बिगेन टू एंटर यूनिवर्सिटीज. मैनी वीमेन बिगेन टू राइट अबाउट द प्लेस ऑफ वीमेन इन सोसाइटी. ताराबाई शिंदे रॉट स्त्री पुरुष पुरुष तुलना. पंडित रमाबाई रॉट अ बुक अबाउट द माइजरेबल लाइव्स ऑफ अपर कास्ट हिंदू वीमेन. पंडिता रमाबाई फाउंडेड अ विडोज होम एट पुणे वेयर वीमेन वर गिवन ट्रेनिंग सो दैट दे कुड बी इकोनॉमिकली इंडिपेंडेंट. बाय द एंड ऑफ 19th सेंचुरी वीमेन रॉट बुक्स. Even they edited magazines, they founded schools and training centers, and even they set up some women associations. In the 20th century, women took part in nationalist and socialist movement, and Orthodox Hindus and Muslims became worried about these changes. So we see caste and social reforms. Caste inequalities cripple our society, and to remove this, some of the reformers took different steps. Ram Mohan Roy translated an old Buddhist text, and it was critical of caste. The Prarthana Samaj, they adhered to the tradition of this bhakti that believed in the spiritual equality of all caste. You see, in Bombay, the Paramhans Mandali was founded 1840 to work for abolition of caste. Do you know Christian missionaries began setting up schools for tribal groups and lower caste children's demand for equality and justice. So now, who are this Guru Ghasidas? See, Guru Ghasidas, he founded the Satnami movements in central India, and he belonged to the lower caste. So he worked among the leather workers and organized a movement to improve their conditions by their social reforms. Next one is Haridas Thakur. He worked among the low caste chandala cultivators in eastern Bengal. He questioned Brahmanical texts and supported caste system. He opposed this. Now answer. Next one is Sri Narayan Guru. Do you know? He was a guru for the low caste Ishwavas in Kerala, and he proclaimed the ideals of unity of all peoples within one sect, a single caste and one guru. Gulamgiri. One of the famous low caste leader was Jyotirao Phule. He protests against the Brahman claimed that they were the superior to others and they were the Aryans. Phule argued that Aryans were outsiders who subjugated to defeat a place or groups of the peoples and force them to obey to you, the true children of the country. The upper caste, so what he said, the upper caste had no right to their land and power. In reality, the land belonged to the low caste who tilled it, and Phule founded Satya Shodak Samaj, which propagated caste equality. So in 1873, Phule wrote Gulamgiri, means slavery. Phule was also concerned about was continued in 20th century by Dr. B.R. Ambedkar in Western India and E.V. Ramaswamy Naikar in the South. Now, next, who could enter temples? How? See, Dr. B.R. Ambedkar belonged to Mahar family. As a child, he experienced that what caste prejudice means in everyday life. In school, he forced to sit in the ground outside the classroom. He not allowed to drink water from the taps which were used by the upper caste. Brahmins priests were outrated when the Dalit used water from the temple tanks. So in 1927, he started a temple entry movement, and he led three such movements for temple entry between 1927 and 1935. What about the non-Brahman movement? The non-Brahman movement started in early 20th century, and the initiative came from educated, wealthy and influential non-Brahman caste. So first one is E.V. Ramaswamy Nayakar. What he done? He founded the city. They saw social divisions and inequality as God-given. So he inspired untouchables to achieve some social equality. He criticized Hindu scriptures for establishing these authorities of Brahmins and over lower castes. Orthodox of Hindu society, it tried to uphold caste distinction as a cornerstone of Hinduism. So some of the associations, you know, like Sanatan Dharma Sama, Bharat Dharma, Mahamandal, Brahman Sabha, it tried to maintain caste distinction. Now, how the these reforms organized? So first one is the Brahmo Samaj. See, these are founded by Raja Ram Mohan Roy in 1828. He prohibited all forms of idolatry, means worship the idols and sacrifice. Next one is Derozio and Young Bengal. Henry Louis Vivian Derozio, a teacher at Hindu College, initiated the Young Bengal movement in 1820s to promote radical idea and encourage his students to question all authorities. Swami Vivekananda and the Ramakrishna Mission. Swami Vivekananda established Ramakrishna Mission, named after Guru Ramakrishna Paramhans, to stress the ideals of salvation through all social services and selfless action. Next is the Prarthana Samaj. Do you know, they established in 1867 at Bombay, and it worked to remove all caste restrictions, abolish child marriage, and the ban on widow remarriage, and it encouraged the Indian women education system. Now the Veda Samaj. It was established in Madras in 1864. It worked to abolish caste distinctions and promote widow remarriage and women education, etc. Aligarh movement. What is this? This movement was launched by Sir Syed Ahmad Khan to revive the spirit of progress within the Muslim community of India. Singh Sabha movement. Do you know, this movement sought to rid Sikhisms of superstition, caste distinctions and practice seen by them or as non-Sikh. Now, see some questions here. How did the knowledge of ancient texts help the reformers to promote law? The reformers tried to improve the status of the women in the society using the knowledge of ancient texts. So what type of efforts they are made? First, Raja Ram Mohan Roy pointed out the practice of widow burning had no sanction in ancient texts. Next, Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar used ancient texts to suggest that widow could remarry. Swami Dayanand showed that many social evils of today had no religious sanctions in the Vedas. What were the different reasons the people had for not sending the girls to school? First, they feared that the girls would schools would take girls away from home. It prevent them from doing the domestic duties. They felt that the girls should stay away from public places. Girls had to travel through public places in order to reach the schools. So this would have corrupting influence on them. Why was the Christian missionaries attacked by many peoples in the country? Because people did not support these activities. What are these supported activities? Now, Christian missionaries during 19th century, they began setting up schools for tribal groups and lower caste children. Next, in the British period, what new opportunities opened for peoples who came from the caste that were regarded as low? So, see some following points. Poor began leaving their villages to look for the jobs that were opening in the cities, and there was work in the factories and job in municipalities. Drains had to dug, roads laid, buildings constructed and cities cleaned. Coolies, diggers, carriers, bricklayers, sewage cleaners, sweepers, rickshaw pullers, etc. came in the city. Now some of them also want to work on plantation in Assam, Mauritius, Trinidad and Indonesia. Poor and the people from the low caste, they saw this is an opportunity to get away from this oppressive hold of the upper caste landowners. The father of the father of Bhimrao Ambedkar, the leader of the Dalit movement, he taught at an army schools. How did the Jyotirao, the reformer, justify his criticisms of caste leader? See, he criticized the caste inequality in our society in following ways. What are these? First point, he opposed the idea of Brahman were superior just because they were Aryans. He argued that Aryans were foreigner who came from outside the subcontinent and they defeated and subjugated the two children of country. These native peoples had lived here from before coming of the Aryans. He claimed that the upper caste had no rights to land and power. In reality, the land belonged to the natives of the country. Third, he proposed all the lower castes should unite to challenge this caste discrimination system. By writing the book Gulamgiri, which means slavery, in 1873, Jyotirao justified his opinion about the caste inequality in a society. Why did Phule decided his book Gulamgiri to American movement to free slaves? Do you know, in 1873, Jyotirao Phule wrote a book named Gulamgiri, meaning slavery. Phule dedicated this book to all those Americans who fought to free slaves. Some 10 years before the publication of his book, American Civil War had been fought, and this war led to the end of slavery in America. By deciding his book to the American movement, he tried to establish a link between the conditions of the lower caste of India and the black slaves in America. Why did Ambedkar want to achieve through the temple entry movement? See, in 1927, B.R. Ambedkar started a temple entry movement because Brahmin priests were outraged when Dalit used water from the temple entry. Between 1927 and 35, which he wanted to make everyone to see the power of caste prejudice within the system. Why were Jyotirao Phule and Ramaswamy Nayakar critical of the national movement? Did the criticism help the national struggles in any way? Yes, see. Jyotirao Phule was critical of anti-colonial nationalism that was preached by the upper caste leader. He urged that unity between high and low caste in our country so it will make progress. Ramaswamy Nayakar also criticized the national movement. When was member of Congress, he attended a feast which is organized by nationalists. He founded sitting arrangement during that time. Here he was caste distinction. Lower castes were made to sit distant from the upper caste. So their ideas were respected and helped to strengthen the national struggle. So the forceful speeches, his writings and movements of lower caste leaders did lead to rethinking and some self-criticisms among the upper caste nationalist leader. So now we have studied the two lessons, and in next I'll take the civics. Thank you.